Yeah, when I first got my PhD, a little kid came up to me and said, "You're Dr. Price? Are you the kind that helps people or the other kind?" So I am the other kind. And tonight, I want to remind you that the bar has been raised pretty high with this wife thing. So let me give you a bit of our background. First off, she's a godly wife. My kids, looking at her and then looking at me, said, "Mom, why did you marry him?" And to which she replied, "God told me to." So if she was not an obedient, godly wife, I wouldn't have a chance. But let me say that we met at it's been an adventurous life. We met at a ski camp in Colorado. We married while we were at Dallas Seminary. From Dallas Seminary, moved here to Jerusalem. In fact, we lived in a house not more than a block across the street. We had our second daughter born at Hadassah Hospital, just up the way here. And then we have been involved coming over here 108 times. So that's been busy. And some of those, at least for the last 15 years, have been archaeological projects. And she has worked beside me on all of those, just flexible, giving herself to the Lord, and digging with me, looking for these precious things. But I can tell you the most precious treasure I've ever found is sitting right there. This week, you have been going to the places of the past. And tonight I'm going to focus on the future. And so going to that list of your speakers, preacher, professor, expositor, storyteller, I guess I'm going to have to be prophet, okay, somewhere in there. All right, so let me first talk about this subject of rebuilding the temple. And the main question that people ask is, why hasn't it got done before now? After all, the Jewish people are in control of this country. They have sovereignty over the Temple Mount. So why hasn't it happened? And to answer that, let's look at a little story from this region called The Crocodile and the Scorpion. All right, it goes something like this. There was a crocodile who was sunning himself on the banks of the Nile, and out of the desert comes a scorpion. And the scorpion comes up to the crocodile and says, "Friend crocodile, I'd like to get across the Nile, and I'd like to ride on your back. How about that?" Now, the crocodile looks at the scorpion and says, "Nothing doing. If you get on my back and we start out on the Nile, you'll sting me and then I'll die." Now, the scorpion said, No. He said, "Think about it. If I stung you, we'd both die." Oh. So the crocodile said, "Let's go." And off they go, but no sooner did they get on the way, then the scorpion gets agitated, as is its nature, and stings the crocodile, and now they're sinking beneath the waves. And the crocodile says, "What possible reason could you have for doing this?" And the scorpion answers, "There is none. This is the Middle East, okay?" Well, that's the way it's supposed to go. Let's see. There, okay. Now, if you're from the Middle East, you understand that, okay? That answers all the questions. And when we come to the Temple Mount, you know this is probably the most conflicted and volatile acreage on earth. There just isn't another place that is in the headlines and has the potential to be back in the headlines. And maybe this week, if you entered the Temple Mount wearing your Star of David or Israel t-shirt or kippah, you could have been on those front lines, okay, headlines. Because from the Israeli side, what has happened is, from their point of view, perhaps an atrocity, that they come back to the one place that they have turned and prayed to three times a day for the last 2,000 years in absence of a temple. And now that they are back, why shouldn't they have the right to rebuild that most sacred space? And so it seems incredible that their government and that the world stands in opposition to that. And then from the Islamic point of view, this has, for the last 1,300 years, been their sacred space. And even though it's kind of down the line as we count sacred spaces in Islam, nevertheless, they say that Al-Aqsa, the name for the whole 35-acre platform, is only for Muslims. And there was a time when only Muslims could go there. And only in the 19th century was that changed a bit. And only in the 20th century, now with 1967, the return to the Temple Mount and the status quo arrangement, has that been possible for people like us to go to the Temple Mount, but yet with difficulty. But, so what's this whole thing about the temple anyway? Well, let's look at the temple's past purpose. There is a reason why God made this structure. It's certainly more than a structure, but the reason he brought it to earth. And I have to go back to the very beginning of Genesis. I remember when I wrote a book on this, and a friend of mine is a theologian, Dr. Wayne House. He called me on the phone and said, "How's the book coming?" I said, "Well, I'm writing a chapter now on the temple in the book of Genesis." He said, "Well, that's why it's taken so long. There's nothing about the temple in Genesis." Well, I'm talking about symbolism that's here. But if you look at the picture, you see that God's presence was in a garden. And there was a tree of life, and there was a tree of knowledge of good and evil. And there were cherubim, as we come to the story later on, that stood at the east of Eden to guard the entrance into that holy presence of God. And so the direction of God was in the west, and the direction away from God was to the east. And so if you wanted to approach him, you had to come back to him. But there was a problem. Sin had made an intrusion, and so therefore you could not return to God, because unholy man has no place with holy God unless something else happens. And so when we look at the picture in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 24, man was driven from the presence of God out at the east of the garden and prevented from coming back to his presence. And this was an exile at that time. But we found a resolution, at least we did, and God did. And he did it at Mount Sinai. And that's the beautiful picture here, that God returned his people to himself. He did it by himself. He did it somewhat in spite of Israel, but he did it because he had promised to do it. And the scripture at that time, Exodus 25:8, was, "Let them make for me a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst." And I want to focus on that word dwell. That's the same term, by the way, we have for the structure. Mishkan is simply the noun form of shikan, to dwell. So it was a dwelling place. And when Moses was given these instructions on Mount Sinai, God said, "According to all that I'm going to show you, as the pattern of the tabernacle and all the pattern of its future, its furniture, so you shall construct it. And see that you make them after the pattern which was for them, which was shown to you on the mountain." Now, what is this all about? Well, if we look at it, there is a heavenly temple. This is the place where God dwells. And the text tells us here, it has the word tavnit. Tavnit is a term that means something like design or plan or pattern, even a copy, model, or blueprint, so that we have what was in heaven shown in some way to Moses so he could copy it on earth. And later, the author of Hebrews says the things that are on earth are copies of things that are in heaven. So there's a real reality of the presence of God that was brought to earth. He wanted to bring a little bit of heaven to earth in this case, because there was no holy spot on earth left. And in order to have that relationship with him, his presence had to be there. So when we come to this thing we call the tabernacle, look how it mimics what was in the Garden of Eden. At the very west, you had the presence of God in the Holy of Holies. And you had a barrier, the cherubim, preventing entrance, but also on the Ark of the Covenant, welcoming man to come to the presence of God, but now only one way, through a mediator. Now there had to be someone who came between God and man who would apply the blood that would cover or appease, or we could say in other terms, kind of cleanse, purify a man so that in God's sight he would be what he needed to be. And so the direction, again, of man in exile in the east is to return back to God in the west. So it fits that kind of place. So to the place where God dwells, where we can be safe with him in our fallen state, is what the tabernacle was all about. It was a way God could bring us back to himself. Now, as I mentioned, this term mishkan comes from the verb, And we have something very interesting when we come to the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament. It says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Now, we have the word Shekinah. This is the term for the dwelling of God, the presence of God. But when you come to the Greek text there, and I hate to say this with Daryl right in front of me, but skenao, skene, it's to me sort of a transliteration of this Hebrew term, Shekinah, okay, the dwelling of God. So that when we talk about Yeshua coming from heaven, being incarnated on earth, it is as though he were tabernacling, dwelling with us, as God intended from the beginning. So again, he is the mediator between God and man to bring us to God, to make those things that are unholy, holy, and declare us righteous in his sight. So that's what we see here. Now we move forward in time and we see Abraham. He was called to a place, and he called that place Adonai Yireh, the idea that the Lord has seen and he has provided is the idea. Same root, ra'ah, to see or provide in the Niphel stem, if some of you know what that is regularly used for the Lord appearing to men. So we have almost this sense of God appearing. And as you know, in Genesis 18, God did do that. There were three figures that came. Today, my group went to Mamre, where that event actually happened. And there we had three men that came to Abraham and Sarah. And one of those was Hashem, the Lord himself, because it tells us that the two men went down to Sodom and Abraham is left standing before Adonai, the Lord. And he has this conversation. Well, it's very interesting to be in that kind of situation. God had to take the form of man. He had to incarnate temporarily. He had to have vocal cords to speak. He had to justicism to eat the food that Abraham gave him. He had to have all the other types of things to move and do as men do. So if God can do that on a temporary basis, why not a permanent one? And that's exactly what happened in the incarnation. We are made in the image of God. He has no problem assuming the image he made, because as Psalms 8 says, we were made a little lower than Elohim. So it's a wonderful thing. And I say that, I mentioned to my group today. One time I talked to a rabbi here, and he said, how can you worship a God that uses the bathroom? As though that were going to affect me. And I said, you don't understand the humiliation of Messiah, that in the incarnation, he was made a child, a helpless babe. And yet he was still the glorious God who created all the world around. This is what we see. Abraham had some sense of that when he was called, because instead of offering his son Isaac, in his place was put a ram, a male sheep, which represented the Messiah who was to come. And in that, as he talks about in this mount, it will be provided, we have a four view of the temple and how God would provide for the sin of men there, and ultimately the great sanctuary that would be provided through the body of Messiah himself. Now, in that, God chose a place, and he chose Jerusalem. We see this in the Psalms. He said, the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his habitation. This is my resting place, Menuchati, forever. Here I will dwell, Chashav, for I have desired it. So he wants to come and be with us. This is all about a relationship. Why is it that God would desire that? Well, he made us for himself, and we are forever unfit or missing something or out of place until we find that relationship for which we were made. So the psalmist said that, and it's never been changed. God set his name on Jerusalem, and it remains. And that is explaining for us a little bit about the temple. I made a chart in one of my books one time about this. We have the first temple, which deals with the temple in the past, and we'll look at that for a moment. Second temple that came from that after a 70-year exile. We have today no temple existing, but we do have a temple. We have a spiritual temple, which is the body of Messiah. And it's quite clear, Ephesians 2, 19 through 21, that this is the temple of the Lord. But it's a spiritual temple. Material temple is gone. My feeling is with the taking up of that spiritual temple, the physical temple will then be allowed to return. If I'm reading prophecy in the correct way, that brings us to a third temple, and then finally to the time of the return of Messiah when the Messianic temple will stand. So that's kind of the outline we're following. So let's look first at the temple in the past. With Solomon, there was the command of God to build the temple, and his presence, his Shekinah, came and filled it. And the articles what was left of the tabernacle came and filled it as well. So it was placed in there. And God said, I have consecrated this temple which you have built by putting my name there forever, and my eyes and my heart will always be there. Which is why he then commanded people to pray toward this place. And he said, wherever you are on the face of this earth, if you turn toward this place and pray, I will hear from heaven, and I will, you know, heal your land or do whatever it was that the covenant required. On Yom Kippur, within this temple, God said, I will meet you there above the mercy seat. Now, not all people and not all Kohanim, only one, the Kohen HaGadol, the great high priest. And he would come representing Israel, carrying them on his shoulders, on his breastplate, with the word Kadosh L'Adonai, holy, across his head. He would come before God, but not seeing God. The Holy of Holies was completely dark. He would then bring incense in to fill the room even more. And so he was there as a representative of fallen, sinful man, bringing blood to put on the mercy seat of the ark to receive mercy for all of Israel. And of course, that atonement is available for any who will come to him. So he said, here I will speak to you about all that I will give commandment for the sons of Israel. So again, a relationship was there. You come, I'll speak, and we will continue to live. Unfortunately, as we know the story, Israel, in its leadership of the nation, failed, and God does hold the nation accountable based on those who are its leaders, just as it does today. And so when that happened, God allowed his presence to be removed and foreign enemies to come and destroy the first temple. But after that, and after this time of discipline, God says, I will return you, and you will rebuild the ancient ruins and raise up the age-old foundations. And this was to be done exactly in the same place, because God's presence had sanctified that site, which is why the rabbis tell you today, the Orthodox rabbis, that no Jew can go to the Temple Mount, because they don't know where the Holy of Holies stood. They don't know where the Ark of the Covenant may be buried beneath the site, if that's the case. And you would inadvertently tread on it with your unholy state, and therefore render it ritually impure. So you have to walk in a certain prescribed path all around it. But nevertheless, the temple was to be built where the temple had been built, and it will always have to be built in the same place. So we move ahead just a bit in time to Herod the Great. Some of you have walked around the remains of this site, much larger, much grander than the first temple, but lacking something the first temple had, and that was the presence of the Ark of the Covenant. Because now we're in a temple built by, well, less than a sterling character of Herod, built originally under the Hasmonean reign, which was considered by many illegitimate. The Zadokite priesthood should have been there, and they placed it with their own people. So within the Holy of Holies, that foundation stone was barren, and the high priest would go and pour blood on it, but it did not have what the first temple had, which meant something still needed to be restored in the future. We come to this story again. The history repeats itself. On the ninth of the Hebrew month of Av, the first temple fell. On the ninth of the Hebrew month of Av, the second temple fell. And it was no coincidence. This was clearly the work of God. And Luke tells us in chapter 19, days shall come upon you when your enemies will throw up a bank before you, surround you, hem you in on every side, level you to the ground, and your children within you. And they will not leave you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation. Lots of theories as to why the temple was destroyed, but this statement of Yeshua is the only one that really has merit. God did it as a further discipline for the Jewish nation. But he also, in another place, held out the hope of the future. He said, your house is being left to you desolate until, and Daryl, if I want to say it five times in a row, I guess it would work, but until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And that is a day that's coming. So this is the hope for all Israel. Now, today we live in a time called the times of the Gentiles. And Luke 21 says, they will fall by the edge of the sword, be led captive to all the nations, and Jerusalem be trampled down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. You must recognize that the presence on the Temple Mount today, that which really holds authority there, are Gentiles. This is the Arab Islamic authority. And because of that, even though Israel has sovereignty over the country, and actually sovereignty over the site, they do not have jurisdiction or have practical ability to do what may be in the heart of many Jews to do. So, because we're still in the times of the Gentiles, and that will last until it's fulfilled, and that's coming as well. Now, there is the Avodah, and in the Amidah too, which is the daily prayer, Benediction 17 prays, restore the most holy service of your house and accept in love the offerings and prayers of Israel. May it please you always to accept the service of your people Israel. May our eyes see you. Return to Zion in mercy. Bless you, Lord, who restores his presence to Zion. Because as you know, it isn't here. You may go to the Kotel. You can put your messages there. And there is the Jewish tradition that he hideth behind the wall based on the idea from the Song of Songs. But you know, he's not there, really there, because his presence can't be seen, can't be felt. The nation hasn't changed. There isn't that relationship with him yet. So this explains the temple's present problem. Just walk through it with me. 691, there was the Dome of the Rock built at the site where the former temple stood. And the rest of the site there was turned into the city dump. That's why you walk through the dung gate, because that's where they carried, well, the refuse of the city to dump it on the Temple Mount. And this was a type of supersessionism that the Byzantine Empire, through first Constantine and his mother, Queen Helena, imposed on the site. But we also have the tradition in Islam that this is the site of the ascension of Muhammad to heaven on a celestial steed called Al-Burak, head of a woman, wings of an eagle, tail of a peacock, and body of a horse. And it says he went from the near mosque to the far mosque, Al-Aqsa. So even though originally and almost every intellectual among Muslims will admit this, there was no mosque in Jerusalem because the Muslims didn't arrive here until 5 years after Muhammad's death. The only mosque at that time was in Medina, about 200 miles away from Mecca, so that has to be the far mosque. Nevertheless, in the mystical way of a tradition, it gets transferred here so that he went from the Dome of the Rock to heaven and returned. And by the way, that Kotel that was negotiated, you know, the Jews will be below and the Muslims will be above and we'll all be happy and get along. No, no, no. The Kotel is actually Al-Burak Wall because that's where he tethered his celestial steed. So you don't get out of it that easy. Nevertheless, when we look at the way the Muslims worship, they don't turn toward the Dome of the Rock, which is the site of the temple. They turn away from it toward Mecca. Even though Muhammad originally said, pray this direction, the Jews that he was trying to appease didn't respond, and so he, a little abrogation, jumped in, and he said, face the other way and pray. So it is not the same as the Jewish people who pray toward the temple. Now, on June 7th, 1967, something happened that changed the political landscape, and that was the return to Jerusalem. Israel returned to the Temple Mount. The Muslims surrendered the sacred sites, but Moshe Dayan sat down of his own thinking in the Al-Aqsa Mosque with leaders and said, we'll turn the site back to you, but we have sovereignty over it, which really ultimately meant nothing in time. But at the time, the Muslims were thinking, oh, they'll tear down this place, build their temple. I've talked to many of them who said, that's what we thought would happen. And you know, if the situation were reversed, that's probably what would have happened, but did not happen. Instead, Israelis jumped into the realm of archaeological excavation at the foot of the Temple Mount. And Benjamin Mazar uncovered many things that proved, of course, this was the site and the site of the destruction as well. And this is, you'd think archaeology and apolitical science would not affect politics, but in Jerusalem, archaeology is politics. Because the very stones of Jerusalem are political weapons that are used in the age-old struggle for possession of the Holy Land. Here's an example of that, Palestinian revisionist history. This is a statement by the chief Palestinian justice, Sheikh Tassar Tamimi. He said this, Israel started since 1967 making archaeological digs to show Jewish signs to prove the relationship between Judaism and the city. And they found nothing. There is no Jewish connection to Israel before the Jews invaded in the 1880s. About these two so-called temples, they never existed, certainly not at the Temple Mount. All of this is not real. We don't believe in your versions. Your Torah was falsified. These are the kind of things that Jewish people, as well as believers in Messiah, have to contend with. And it's ideology, but it's also religion, of course. Ahmed Korea, who is the chief Palestinian negotiator, put it this way, the Jewish temples never existed. Israel has been working to invent a Jewish historical connection to Jerusalem and the Temple Mount, but all these attempts will fail. The Haramesh Sharif, the name they give to the structure, is 100% Muslim. Now this has become, over time, the official position, not only the Palestinian Authority, but really the whole Arab world. And so we call it temple denial. It just never happened. It's all a great fiction from their point of view, which is why it's so important for you to have come and walked around the Temple Mount to let the stones speak for themselves to show you the reality of the facts of faith and of the scriptures. Now, we have, of course, others in the international community that are joining the bandwagon of this temple denial. UNESCO, as you know, have said in the past the Jews have no connection to the Temple Mount. Temple Mount's no longer Jewish. All these things that happened. There were several votes on this, and I wish I could say it reversed itself, but it didn't. And yet, despite all of this, we turn to Muslim sources. And here is one. This is a brief guide to the Haramesh Sharif published by the Supreme Muslim Council. This one's from 1935. There are earlier ones from the 1920s that go all the way through the 1950s and have exactly the same thing to say. And this is the first statement in this guidebook written in English to Christian tourists or any tourist to the Temple Mount. Again, written by the Muslim authorities. It says this. This site is one of the oldest in the world. Its sanctity dates from the earliest times. Its identity with the Temple of Solomon is beyond dispute. Well, how can that be? Well, what happened? Well, 1948 happened, and then worse, 1967 happened. And as a result, things have been in response to that. Now, as I said, those who are more intellectuals and academics see it differently. This particular gentleman I found on TV, he said, he's an Egyptian scholar. He says, Al-Aqsa is not ours. It does not refer to the far mosque on the Temple Mount, but rather to a mosque that is further of the two mosques in Mecca. The only reason why Muslims insist on the sanctity of Jerusalem is simply politics. All right. And here, interestingly enough, most of you know where Al-Quds University is. This is Sari Nusa Bey, the president of Al-Quds. He said this, if you went back a couple of hundred years before the advent of the political form of Zionism, I think you will find that many Muslims would not have disputed the connection the Jews have toward the Temple Mount. The problem began arising with the advent of Zionism, when people started connecting a kind of feeling the Jews have toward the area with the political project of Zionism. And that's basically the facts. Now, let's move to the temple's future plan, because I don't care how many problems we have now and how irreconcilable it may be and how impossible the rebuilding of the temple could be, nothing is impossible with God. And so he has said this. So look at the scriptures. Isaiah 2:2-3, a well-known passage. Now it will come about in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains and be raised above the hills, and all the nations will stream to it. Now may I say, the nations have always streamed toward Jerusalem to make war, but in the future they'll stream to make worship. And that's a totally different picture that we see drawn. And of course also here, peace will be established for all the planet. And then Isaiah 27:13, it will come about also in that day that a great trumpet will be blown, and those who were perishing in the land of Assyria and who were scattered in the land of Egypt, former enemies of Israel, will come and worship the Lord in the holy mountain at Jerusalem. This is the idea of even the Gentiles and the enemies being brought into a relationship with the Lord. And some of you know the passage in Isaiah 19 that says, you know, Egypt, my people, Assyria, the work of my hands. What an amazing thing will happen. And that's not happening now, but it will. And then we have even a statement, and those of you that walked around the Temple Mount, I'm sure you didn't see any stream of water coming from beneath the Dome of the Rock, but one day it will come from beneath the threshold of the temple. Ezekiel says these waters go out, and this is a stream that comes out from the Holy of Holies, toward the eastern region, will go down to the Arabah, and they will go down toward the Dead Sea, being made to flow into the Dead Sea, and its waters will become fresh. Now, they'll leave a few marshes there in case people who didn't get to tour, you know, haven't seen the Dead Sea in part of that brackish water, but really it's going to be restored, be fruit trees, all kind of things there. Now, these kind of prophecies motivated Orthodox Jews, but 1967 motivated them more. One of these was Gershon Solomon, who was in a paratroop unit, and when the area of the, shall we say, the Temple Mount came into their hands, he was there, and he felt like something should be done. But 1987 was the time when it got done. This was when the first Intifada happened, and people were afraid that a reversal of the whole situation would happen, and Jews would lose anything that they had. So Gershom would march, and Gershom had a cornerstone erected, saying nothing more than declaring that we have already established a temple with this one stone. Wake up, O Israel. And then another man, Rabbi Israel Ariel, founded the Temple Institute based on the same kind of principle of being there in 67. Some of you have been there, have seen the treasures of the temple, all these various items that are made halakhically correct for actual use in a third temple. And along with that, we have priests practicing their duties now at different times of the year, including Pesach and Yom Kippur. A sacrificial altar has been created. Of course, none of this is taking place on the Temple Mount, but there are people being made ready for that day, and that must mean something. There's also the hunt for the holy heifer, because in order to do any of this work, you have to have the ashes of the red heifer to purify the person who would do the work. And there's a hunt for this thing now. Numbers 19 was the background for it. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 13 is an interesting New Testament statement. It says, "For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer, sprinkling those who have been defiled, sanctify for the cleansing of the flesh." There is some effect for this, something that is possible. Now, latest candidate, pure red heifer. It's in Baja, Mexico. Now, will this be disqualified, sprout of white hair? And to be disqualified, could be. We think we have problems splitting hairs theologically in our circles. Think about this, all right? Now, the Sanhedrin was reconvened on October 13th, 2004, had four goals, and one of those was ultimately to rebuild the temple. So look here, there are blueprints that have actually been drawn up, okay, including all the electrical stuff needed. One day, Orthodox Jews believe the temple will start to be constructed. Now, how on earth? Well, that takes us to this final point. And let me, here comes my unrepentant premillennial Zionism. All right, there's a period called the Tribulation, and the Tribulation is the time of Jacob's trouble or Israel's trouble. According to the text, there's no day like it, so it has not yet happened, and it's unparalleled in history, but it has two parts. It'll be trouble for Israel, but it will be delivered from it. That's all you need to know. That's the outline. You'll be saved from it in the end. And that time of trouble will see a temple rebuilt. Revelation 11:1-2 tells us that something is constructed because it can be measured, and the outer court is left for the nations who will continue to trample it until the time of the return of the Lord. Daniel, we think, has a little outline concerning this. 3.5 years of peace, and then at the midpoint of that, the temple is desecrated, and then we have 3.5 years of great tribulation, in which at the end of this, the Lord climaxes this point by coming and restoring himself to the temple. Just interestingly, and I don't have a lot of time, but let me just say, the Temple Mount will only be decided politically according to some people. Here we have a statement by the Supreme Court in Israel that says this is a judicial ruling and is not possible for us. It goes beyond the kind of boundaries of law. It is the political echelon, not the court, that must give content to the historical meeting the Temple Mount is ours. And then I read a book Cambridge published called Protecting Jerusalem's Holy Sites, and here the guy says, here's the solution. We need we need an international community who will come together, United Nations, UNESCO, Arab League, NATO, EU, Russia, everybody will come together, and also religious leaders that will serve as mediators to make this happen. Well, this is internationalization of Jerusalem has always been a dream of the nations itself. Here was an interesting article I saw. The Sanhedrin asked Putin and Trump to build a third temple in Jerusalem, okay? Not that I put any stock in that, but it simply says this could be the way it happens. And if we read the text in Daniel 9:27, there could be one who strengthens the covenant and makes this possible. Finally, as we come to the end of the tribulation, all nations will be gathered against Jerusalem to do battle. This little place? Why? All the earth. Well, we see it as a reality today. You look at the news, you walk around this land, you see the conflict over Jerusalem, and you realize it could happen in our day, on our time. But climaxing this, the very next verse, it says, the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations as he fights on a day of battle. He will intercede for his people. He will be a true mediator in every way. And in that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which is in front of Jerusalem on the east. And the result of that will be, according to the text in Zechariah, they will basically look upon him whom they have pierced. There will be a great repentance nationally of Israel, and Messiah will be recognized by all, and all Israel will be saved. So following this, Chronicles tells us that he will be settled in my house and in my kingdom forever. Boy, that can't be Solomon or David or anyone like this, because they were never settled in his house. So this is a messianic passage, and that will be a throne established forever. And then finally, when we look at the final state of this, Ezekiel tells us about Jerusalem's glorious future. The name of the city, that is Jerusalem, from that day on shall be Adonai Shema, the Lord is there. So now we've come full circle, okay? Temple in the midst, God puts his sanctuary here, he turns his presence to man, and we are there. I just conclude with this one little statement, because rabbis recognize this. Back in the second century, Rabbi Akiba and his disciples were walking on the ruins of the Temple Mount. Some of you walked at the foot of that near the southwestern wall, and you saw that too. And as they did, a jackal sprung out of the stones, and the disciples remembered a passage in Jeremiah. This was the passage. I will make Jerusalem a heap of ruins, a haunt of jackals. I will make the cities of Judah a desolation without habitat. And they began to weep and wail and tear their garments. But Rabbi Akiba started to laugh. They said, Rabbi, why are you laughing? And here's what he said. And this is so sage-like. If we have seen the prophecies of the temple's destruction come to pass, how much more shall we see the prophecies of its restoration fulfilled? See, there's two sides to this. There's desecration and desolation, but there's also restoration. And God never does one without doing the other, because that's the way he has promised. So finally, in the end, we come to this. The story of the temple moves us from beginning to ending, from protology to eschatology. It forms a continuity through the divine record in promise and fulfillment. If God should begin history with symbols of the sanctuary, should not the end of history expect to find these same elements present to complete God's purpose of dwelling with his creation? The millennial kingdom will be a return to the original divine ideal begun in Eden. Such fulfillment awaits the return of the Lord, the revival of Israel, the restoration of the temple. But when God's presence has been restored to the sanctuary on earth, and the divine purpose will have come full circle, with man restored to a worldwide paradise with fellowship with the Creator and the Redeemer, will never again be interrupted. And that's the purpose. Now, let me just say one thing. In this audience, we've come to Israel, but and many, of course, think they've come because they know the Lord, and I know that's true. But there may be some who came seeking the Lord. And so there is this text, the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, and he is coming, he says. So let me just say, Messiah is coming. Are you going? Right now, you've been here. You may be seeking the Lord. Only he knows. Come to Messiah. He will lead you to Abba, Father. You will have that relationship that you've longed for, and you'll be prepared for that great day of his return and the restoration of Israel. Isn't it amazing? We're sitting right now in the place where all that's going to happen. So what a great time to trust in him. Thank you.